Hi, welcome to a new episode of the Data Discovery Channel. And today my guests are Mark Streuker and Ruben Zorgman. And, well, you may notice that there's something strange about my face. And, well, that's exactly what they are going to explain in this episode of the Data Discovery Channel, how they did that.
Well, glad I have my normal face back. Okay, welcome Ruben, welcome Mark.
Thank you.
Well, we saw what deepfake can do. I must say I'm amazed. it looked pretty impressive. But yeah, I guess for the viewers it's good to introduce what is deepfake and how does it work. Right. And you prepared something for me to explain that.
Yes, we have.
So take it away.
Well, like normal younger people, no offense, Hans. The first thing I actually did is sort of, what is deepfake? So Mark and I wanted to know more about deepfake. We have this Wikipedia term, but basically it's a sort of combination between deep learning and fake.
So that's where the deep comes from?
That's where the deep comes from. Mm-hmm. And that's used widely worldwide.
Yeah, it's a lot in the news lately. Yeah, that it's of course this was fun doing something with my face, but yeah, it's also a bit creepy.
It is a bit creepy, yeah. And well, if you look on the internet, most applications are a bit fun. We've made a small compilation of various scenes in which they put Mr. Bean.
Yeah.
So you see that a lot on the internet. Most people just make funny movies, but there are some serious concerns, of course, using this technology.
But I guess we're not really going to talk about those concerns, but more about the techniques.
A little bit. We're going to talk a little bit about the technique, how this is done, so to say, and we're also going to talk a little bit about the ethics around it.
Okay, good. Well,
so let's indeed. First, one more stop that we have to make is actually what kind of deepfakes there are currently available. Mm-hmm. So, for example, what we did is we had your face and we swapped Mark Rutte on top of it.
Yeah.
And then it's sort of synchronized with the movements on your face. And the other one is actually where you can sort of remodel the face so that it synchronizes with what you are saying. And it's also possible to add words or remove words. So you see like this really small blur happening at your mouth. And then after that, it's almost impossible to notice if it's real or if it's fake.
It's still my mouth that you saw? Yeah, okay.
Yeah, well, in this case, but what you can do with face sync, for example, is that you can let Mark Rutte say things he never said before. So that way you can manipulate the original movie, so to say, and alter the scene. Which is a bit different from swapping the faces, but the underlying technology is both deepfake.
Yeah, okay.
So yes, indeed, the question, how does it work? Well, it's basically, it contains three steps. So we have the extraction phase, then after we train the model, and then after that we create our deepfake.
Okay.
So let's dive into the first part. And it's basically we have our video. So we had your video about our introduction.
Mm-hmm.
That is cut up into frames. So you have now, we have thousands of pictures of Hans
on your laptop
and Mark Rutte.
Yeah.
So I hope people from certain parties are not listening.
That's going to raise some questions.
By the way, for the English watching people not living in the Netherlands, Mark Rutte is our prime minister. That's
He's pretty famous in Holland.
It's like our Donald Trump.
Our Donald Trump.
So after we have extracted the frames from the video, basically what we try is to detect a face. So it can happen, for example, that if there are multiple faces in the picture, that it detects multiple faces. And then after that, it depends on the tilt or the jaw of the face to sort of see, okay, how does it look? And we have to align it. Alignment is very important, including with a lot of other stuff. And then after we have the alignment correct, we cut the face again and we apply some cleaning. So for example, if you have shadows on your face, we want to sort of create a different light so that it's even more efficient to basically merge the two faces together.
Yeah, I noticed because I had to do a lot of retakes.
That's correct. This is not the first attempt that we made. This is our third attempt.
Yeah. But so lighting is pretty important and the scene.
Well, you should be able to do it with lesser quality as well, but that will take a lot more time to train because, there's a lot of more to account for. So it makes it easier if you have, similar lighting conditions with both the source and the target.
And also like the size of the head and stuff like that, but we'll get into that later.
Yeah.
So here's an example of how it looked while it was trying to extract the face and align it once again. Mm-hmm. So you see the two different kind of squares around the face, including a face detection.
Yeah.
And then after that, you see the difference between, okay, it tilted a little bit to the left, yeah, and now it's aligned correctly and it's zoomed in on the face as well. And this is used together with the other thousands of pictures of Mark Rutte to basically create the model.
Yeah.
And that's
and this is where the machine learning comes in, because basically what you try to do is to apply a neural network to do the hard work for you. And in this case, we have used an autoencoder, and what that basically does is that you put an input image and you try to reproduce the same image as output. So basically, you're trying to copy the image. But with one small difference is that in the center of our neural network, we squeeze the size a little bit, so it has to compress the information. And that's basically what you see in this picture. We have two pictures, a boy and a girl, mm-hmm, and they're both being encoded to a compressed format. And then we have one decoder that's able to decode all the characteristics from the boy based on that compressed information. And we make a decoder that can do the same thing for the compressed image of the girl. But because they share the same encoder, they've been compressed with the same algorithm, so to say.
Okay.
So what we do with deepfake is that, for example, we make a compressed image of a facial expression of the boy. I can do a click. And then, we get that compressed image. And what we then do is that we feed that compressed image to the decoder of the girl, because that decoder does not contain all the information. It has to learn how to translate that compressed information into the face of the girl. That's the only thing the decoder can do, because that's all it learned. But now we get the expression of the boy, but with the facial expressions or with the facial characteristics of the girl. I mean, if you look at the eyebrows and the eyes. So that's in a nutshell how it works.
I get the picture.
Yeah. Well, and like Ruben already pointed out, when we have that movie or video, we slice it up in frames, and what we then do is we pick the face from the frame,
mm-hmm,
and then we feed that face to our model, and then that model translates it into a similar face but with different characteristics, and then we merge that into a new picture and then apply some lightening or retouching or to make it look better. And then we compile all these pictures back into one movie. We copy the audio track and voila, you have a new movie.
Okay.
This is in a real nutshell, but it's the essence.
Yeah. I see here, in the previous example, you had the boy and the girl. So I expected to see me and Mark Rutte in this example.
Yeah.
But this is all the same. I don't see the difference between the left and the right picture.
Yeah, well, there is a slight difference. If you look at the eyebrows and the blushes on the cheeks, it is subtle. But of course, if you have a moving image, it's more obvious.
Okay. Yeah.
This case, the characteristics of the girl are being copied, but you still have the facial expression of the boy.
Of course. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Clear.
So that's where Hans Rutte or Mark Rutte come in. So like we mentioned previously, we first started with a video of Hans on my own laptop, and we tried to run the software, which is Deep Face Lab. And as you see, you can see the specs here that's used. But we had not that many pictures, and we tried even a smaller size of the training algorithm. So it's only 64 by 64 pixels.
Mm-hmm. Which is really small.
Yeah. And as you see as well here, the face of Mark Rutte is sort of blurred.
Yeah.
And here is also very important what we encountered is the lighting from above. So if you do it in an inside setting, it's really important to sort of not stand right underneath the light, because the shadows will make it even harder for the model to basically merge it together.
Yeah. Yeah, you get a lot of shadows from your nose. Yeah.
And we basically ran it for 8 hours on this laptop to sort of see, okay, how does it look and does it work? And we were excited.
Yeah, but after 8 hours, we still ended up with a fairly blurry image. Yeah.
Fast forward a little bit. Basically, what we did is we started up an Azure VM.
Yeah.
Specifically for GPU intense tasks.
Yeah.
You can see the specs here. It's 11 gigabytes of virtual RAM. And we used
Video RAM.
Yeah.
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 And a lot of normal RAM. Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
A lot of normal RAM indeed. We had a lot of more. We also had a lot of more pictures of you. So that also is very important. The more pictures, the better.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
And yeah, like we stated, too many hours of training. The final video that we created of you took around 36 hours.
So
yeah.
And basically what we then had is a sort of loss. So basically how good the quality can be was at 0.6. And for an optimal result, you should go below 0.09.
Yeah. At least. So yep. If we had let it run for like another couple of days, it might have been even a better result. Yeah. But well, at some point we were like, okay, we've proven our point. let's stop it and carry on with the demo.
This is training. So if I would deliver a new video of me saying something and I would like to have the same result again, like Mark Rutte is talking like me.
Yeah.
How long would that take?
Again, because basically every new video has to be trained again.
Okay, it's not like a regular machine learning model where you create a model and you provide new input and it produces new output.
Well, I think you can use it, but since our model is not that good, it will probably not give a too good result. But I think that if
because
you train a model,
if
you train a model even further, like 0.09 or even below, I think if you put in a new movie from you, you should be able to get an result, because then it generalizes a lot more. So.
Okay.
And I think the generation of the movie itself also does not take that long, I think.
No, it's basically merging it together, which takes like 5 minutes.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And then after that, it still shows separate frames, mm-hmm. and those frames are combined. And that's what basically the movie is about.
Yeah.
Nice.
So most of the time is spent in training.
So yeah, we had a few recommendations. So basically the start on a GPU. CPU is really not optimal for training something like this.
Yeah, but if I edit videos like these, I also have the need for
a GPU. Sure, so yeah.
That's not very strange.
Yeah, we can really see the difference.
We talk about 30 times more efficient or even faster than that. So like we mentioned earlier, it's also important to have more pictures. The more pictures, the better, basically. But it also takes longer for training. And it's also quite important if you want to run it for a week, then you get better results.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And also, like we mentioned earlier, the lighting, the shadow, skin tone, stuff like that, even the same size of the head, because otherwise you have to take that into account as well.
Yeah, and you can realign a lot of stuff with thousands of options, but that will take more effort then. And we, of course, wanted to do it in an automatic fashion as much as possible.
And it's also really important, once you have all those frames available with the head, that you still manually go through it to detect maybe some false positives, because it's still a machine learning algorithm. So it can happen that, for example, something is detected as a face, which is not actually a face. So that's also good to take into account.
Okay, and you can use any machine learning platform to do this? Deep learning platform?
Yeah, well, basically all you need is an autoencoder, which you could write yourself, but there are a lot of tools available on the internet, on GitHub, that you can just use.
And that's what you did?
That's what we did, So, and those tools are also available on all sorts of platforms. You can run them on Linux, you can run them on Windows,
Mac OS,
perhaps even in the cloud, I don't know. Because the core functionality is very simple. It's just a fairly simple neural network. That's all there is to it. Yeah. So it's not that complex under the hood. It's just a lot of steps involved to get the actual movie, but there's no special hardware involved to get this up and running.
Yeah. Also, side note, if you look on the internet as well, for there are different tools available. You installed one which you luckily sort of still exited before the installation, which would install Bitcoin miners. So be aware.
It's a bit of a shadowy world with the tools. So, be aware what you install.
So you're faked easily.
Yeah. Got fake apps.
Yeah. So we had so basically this is how it works underneath the motor it a little bit.
Yeah.
And now it's okay. Why is this so disrupting? Because as you can see on the screen as well, we have CGI for at least 20, 30 years.
Yeah.
We have Photoshop, which is around for as long as possible.
Mm-hmm.
So and it's still altering a video or altering a frame or a picture.
Yeah. So why is this any different?
Yeah. But that's because we can work with it, and even they predict for like people without any IT skills or really that good of knowledge about computers can start probably somewhere in the next few years also with out-of-the-box tools.
Yeah, I read in the nu.nl article that it will be available for mobile phones. It is already available, but the quality is very bad. But in the next few years, it will be available in high quality.
Yeah. And for everyone, also without any technical skills. So that's what makes it
well, so we will see a lot of these videos, and then it will be hard to tell the difference.
Yes. And the training time will also take down probably, but it's also an environmental aspect because you consume a lot of energy.
Yeah.
And basically what we produced after only 36 hours is, okay, we have one video.
Yeah.
That's a thing that you have to keep in mind as well.
Okay.
Yeah, and well, of course, this was all fun and games, all sorts of funny examples, but there are also companies and startups who are using this technology to make actual serious applications, and well, we'd like to point out a few of them. The first is Project Revoice, which is a collaboration between some scientists and a company called Lyrebird, and what they do is they help people who have ALS, and if you have a if you have ALS in a very bad state, so to say, you can lose your voice, much like Stephen Hawking had at some point. And well, then you get a device from which you can talk, but you have that robotic voice. Now, what this project does, it clones your voice and it makes a new hardware that allows you to speak in your own voice. So if you lose your voice, you can still hang on to your own voice. And they do that with Lyrebird, and that's a company which, well, which basically clones your voice. That's what they do. If you go to their website, you can send in a sample, and then they can clone your voice. So
it's,
that
it's,
way...
It's you can using the technique, but then on voice, audio?
Yeah, because deepfake also works on audio. We've now shown video, but it also works on audio. And if you combine those two, you get really cool results. Because if you look at the second example, there is this organization called Malaria No More. Well, they try to defeat malaria global-wide. And one of the things they did is they asked David Beckham to make a video for them, and he did. But the nice thing about the video is that during the video, he switches to different languages. He just keeps talking. You can hear that the voice is changing, so someone else is speaking, but it's perfectly lip-synced.
And
that dubbing is done by Synthesia, which uses deepfake technology to lip-sync the audio. And they also provide it as a service. So let's say if you have a video for your company and you want to have that in German, you can send that video to them and then they can redub that to German, but perfectly lip-sync. So it looks very natural.
Okay. Well, that's very good for German TV.
There are certain countries who might benefit from that more than other.
Sorry, German watches.
Where you can start to see the sort of moving of the mouth and then there is... no audio.
But the nice thing is, if you combine that, for example, with Lyrebird, you could even, if you, for example, dub it in German, you can even translate the voice of the actor back to the original actor and then dub that into the movie. So you can basically fake the entire scene with AI. And that's going to be very cost effective for people who make movies. And they expect to have quite some startups in this area in the near future.
That's
very cool.
And even elaborating on that further, if you have, for example, like a really cheap actor.
You could switch his face.
You can switch his face afterwards with, for example, David Beckham. And you pay him like 1 million instead of 20 million to be physically there.
You can just rent his face, so to say, instead of his whole body.
Okay, this makes the idea of AI making people lose their jobs a lot more
awesome. Well, about switching faces, that was, well, I think the last example we had. I don't know if you have seen Rogue One.
Of course, I'm a Star Wars fan.
Well, at the end of the movie, and small spoilers here, you see Princess Leia, but because Rogue One is actually happening before the first Star Wars, Princess Leia should look younger than when we first saw her on screen back in 1970. Not everyone was too happy with what they did from the CGI department. The Princess Leia that was shown there was not, well, people were not really too happy with how she looked. And this was done by a professional team with professional artists who made that scene.
Which had quite a high budget as well.
Very high budget. So there was this guy on the internet who was like, well, I can do better with a deepfake. And he actually remade that scene with a deepfake. And that's the one you can see in the middle, which, well, you might vary of what you find better or worse.
Much sharper.
The point here is that someone with a home appliances, so to say, can make this level of special effects just in his bedroom. And that's, well, pretty impressive if you compare that with the technology of a few years back. So
it's not all Mr. Bean and Donald Trump and Barack Obama videos. It also has some
serious
purposes.
Like most techniques.
So,
be aware of what you see on the internet.
Don't trust Hans Rutte.
Okay. Very, very interesting. I heard something about deepfake, but seeing it applied on your own face, well, that's very a bit scary, but also very funny and, very interesting to see how it works. So thank you for explaining this.
You're welcome.
And thank you for watching this video. I hope you liked it and you also have an idea of what deepfake can do and, that you need to be aware of whatever you see. But, we're real, by the way. You're not fake the entire episode. If you like the episode, please like it and subscribe to our channel to always get a notification when we have a new episode. So thanks for watching and see you again next time.
Yeah, bye.